With the Women's Rugby World Cup in Ireland just around the corner, the Rugby Business Network has the privilege of speaking to former England captain Catherine Spencer, who is nowadays using her experiences from the rugby field and applying it to her own business called Inspiring Women. Catherine, thank you for providing us with the opportunity to speak with you.
Absolute pleasure, anytime.
Well, rugby by no means is just a sport for men. Although we know when women decide they want to play rugby, their story of how they got involved is often far more interesting than men's. Why did you decide you wanted to play this physically demanding sport?
Yeah, I mean, for me, when I started, without giving my age away too much, about 30 years ago, it was really rare for girls to play rugby at all. I started there because my dad played rugby, and I've got two brothers who play rugby, including a twin brother. So I went off up to my local club, Folkestone, to play mini rugby on a Sunday morning at about the age of 7 or 8 and just played with the boys. And for me, it was normal. It took a little while to get used to it, but I absolutely loved it and was included in the team. So, yeah, for me, very much my family. That was the reason that I got into sport and got into rugby.
Fantastic. Well, Catherine, choosing to play rugby was, in hindsight, the best decision you made, as it led you down the path of playing for England, captaining the national team, and participating in not one, but two Rugby World Cups. Despite losing in the finals, though, in 2006 and 2010, both times to New Zealand, would you still say that was the highlight of your international career spanning 7 years and with 63 caps?
Oh, it's tricky, isn't it? I mean, getting to the World Cup final obviously is an achievement, and I have to recognise that. Obviously, when I look back, I look at it and think, oh, blimmin' hell, we lost those finals, but we were very close. I think for me, I've got a couple of highlights, and certainly stood on the middle of the Twickenham Stoop packed stadium at the beginning of the 2010 World Cup final as captain, facing the Hacker with a crowd singing Swing Low. It was an amazing, absolutely amazing moment. But I think there's probably, you know, two or three highlights as a rugby player, I suppose. In 2009, we beat the Black Ferns, we beat New Zealand at Twickenham. And at the time, that was the first time they'd lost a game since 2001. Wow. And it was a real kind of boost for us as players. And also, I think, really contributed to the profile of us as a sport, and people really sort of started to pay attention to us. You know, we'd just beaten the world champions at home a year out from the World Cup. So that was a massive moment for us as a team. And individually, it was my 50th cap, so it was a really nice occasion to win that, you know, with a game on television as well. And I'm normally about shy about these things, but I did get player of the game that day, and the only try. So that was quite a nice highlight. We enjoyed our celebrations after that. And then there's a couple more, I think. In 2006, we went over to France and played France in the Six Nations. And as a squad, we'd lost to them in the 2 years previously. And we went over to 2006. It's always a challenge, a really great, exciting challenge playing France in France. It's a fantastic atmosphere. And we just clicked as a squad, and particularly as a pack of forwards. We just had one of our best games at that point, and we beat France 27-0, I think it was, and silenced the crowd, which is always a good sign in France. And it was just fantastic for us and really kind of shot us forward again. And individually, I never lost to France. In a full England shirt again. And probably the other highlight for me, and it's one that I'll always remember, was playing for Folkestone Rugby Minis under 10, I think it was. I'd started playing and I wasn't that confident, and I hadn't really done that much on the pitch to date. We're playing in a mini rugby festival, and the opposition kicked the ball ahead, and I was playing out on the wing, and that changed soon after, and caught the ball, and I just ran for it. And my dad and my older brother were watching, and they remember saying, you know, they were watching me, and they thought, oh yeah, we think, you know, Catherine, she can actually play rugby. And that was kind of a bit of a defining moment for me, I think.
Some fantastic memories to look back on. Well, the 2014 Rugby World Cup, England won it, and so they'll be the defending champions at the upcoming tournament, which runs from the 9th to the 26th of August in Ireland. The ladies are in camp right now preparing. What expectations do you have for England at this World Cup?
Yeah, I mean, they've had a bit of a rocky road since 2014 with the balance between sevens and 15s, and the 2 years straight after, you know, the last World Cup was not so successful with 15s. But they've got everyone back in the squad now. They've just had a really successful tour over to New Zealand, beat New Zealand in New Zealand, which is no mean feat, and beat Canada as well, who also obviously a very strong nation, were in the last World Cup final. So, you know, they've had good preparations. They've been fortunate enough to be in camp. They haven't been having to be out at their day jobs leading up to this World Cup. So I think they're in a really strong position, and will definitely be aiming to retain their title. And they could, I think, they really could. I think New Zealand are going to be really strong in this World Cup, though. You know, they missed out on the last World Cup, and there's no way that they'll want to crash out of this year's tournament. So I have a sneaky suspicion it will be once again a New Zealand-England final.
Well, it's going to make for some fantastic viewing. Catherine, we recently saw England win the Women's Cricket World Cup, while women's football is growing at a very rapid rate. Where would you say women's rugby is at the moment, and do you feel enough attention is being given by the World Rugby governing body?
That's a nice question, thank you. well, yeah, I mean, you know, we talk about it all the time, women's sport growing, and just at this moment, we're in a really nice time for women's sport. And as you say, the cricket winning the World Cup, which was fantastic, really great scenes to see that. Football, women's football doing well, and the coverage they get is great, and their participation numbers are fantastic and growing all the time. And, and women's rugby's been growing, and, you know, I've been able to sort of experience the game over the last 30 years and seen massive growth, undoubtedly. But I think we have a way to go, to be honest. You know, you know, women's football in the FA Cup final last year, I think it had about 30,000 people there watching, and that's, you know, that's unprecedented in the women's rugby game. You know, we're way behind that. So there is investment into women's premiership in England next year. That's the area of the game that we really need to be targeting. Not necessarily improve the quality, but improve the infrastructure, you know, and kind of really try and push those brands and get more people along watching Premiership, you know, and Championship and League Rugby, but specifically more people watching Premiership World Rugby in the women's game. And, you know, around the world, it's growing as well. You know, I've been fortunate enough to travel with a charity that I'm involved with, and lots of times over to Africa, and I've also been to India and Mexico, and I've seen women playing rugby and trying to grow the game in their countries. And I think there's more women playing rugby in corners of the world that just wouldn't imagine or wouldn't expect, which is fantastic. You know, it's a sport that should be available and open to all. I think we can still continue to push it a bit more, to be honest. There's great focus on sevens in the women's game, but I think we should be continuing to push 15-a-side rugby as the game that's accessible to all. So, yeah, whilst there have been improvements and there has been growth, there really needs to be a lot more, in my opinion.
Definitely. Well, following your days on the rugby field as a player, you still felt the need to make a difference for the sport as you went on to become Women's Regional Development Manager and then Women's Rugby Development Officer at the RFU for just over 3 years. What did your jobs entail at the union, and was it rewarding in any way?
Rewarding in any way. It was rewarding in some ways, yes. It was a challenging job, actually. And so I first started working, actually it was for the RFUW then, before they were integrated to the RFU, in 2010, just after the World Cup. So I was working previously as an office manager at a sports centre near Bristol, and I loved my job, and I'd been working there since 2006. But leading up to 2010 World Cup, I just did not want to think about anything else, so I left my job. Was potentially a bit foolish, but without a job to go to after the World Cup. And in the build-up, this job was advertised as a women's regional development manager for the South West, where I was living near Bristol. And so I applied for the job, had to go to an interview at 9 o'clock in the morning after we'd been on a 3-day training camp with the army. So I wasn't in the best shape, but got through the interview, obviously, and got the job. And so I started that in the October after the 2010 World Cup. And that was all about developing women and girls rugby, particularly at grassroots level. So whether playing or coaching or refereeing. And I worked covered the counties of Bristol, Gloucester, Somerset and Devon, and it was a really nice area to work in. You know, the South West are so pro rugby, which was fantastic, and the volunteers down there were brilliant. We didn't have much resource in terms of community rugby coaches in the South West, so everyone was particularly innovative and proactive, and we saw really nice growth in numbers, particularly in Somerset. Which was fantastic, and that's sort of continued, and it's really nice to see that. And then I transferred over to the southeast when we integrated into the RFU and did a similar job down here. So it was a good job, and when I was out, watching girls playing rugby on the pitch and seeing some fantastic tries being scored and some fantastic tackles being put in. It was really nice. It was also a job that required relationship building and influencing and mediating and all those kind of people skills that I'd actually developed in my time as captain, and they were definitely needed at the time. So it was challenging at times, of course it was, and it was, I would say, rewarding at times.
Ah, that's brilliant. Well, Catherine, in 2014, you took the exciting and sometimes daunting task of starting up your own business, and you're now the CEO of Inspiring Women. Please tell our listeners what your company does.
Yeah, I did, and it was a fairly difficult decision to go from a a secure job in a world that I knew, in a rugby world that I knew, with all the security that comes with a full-time full-time employment and a pension and sick leave and holiday and a car to handing my resignation in and not having any of that, not having a car for 6 months, that was so yeah, but I made the decision to leave and start up my business, Inspiring Women, which is primarily a platform to find and encourage more female speakers. So it provides motivational speakers from the world of sport and adventure to go into businesses and schools. All the speakers are female. I felt passionately that there were so many females out there from a similar background to mine that had great stories to say, have great stories to tell, but also that we just needed that encouragement that we do have value and people do want to listen to us. So I felt strongly that there should be a platform there for that. So that was why I started Inspiring Women. And it's been a great couple of years. Hard, tough, I'm not going to deny that. But a great couple of years. I've learned so much. And I've got a fantastic raft of speakers now who are going out and about and speaking to businesses and speaking to schools. And it's such a nice thing to be able to provide. And alongside that, I'm doing a lot of speaking myself, which I'm really enjoying. I love it. And it might be an infant school assembly one day, or it might be a corporate bank in London the next day. And it's so nice, that kind of transfer from sport into businesses. There's so many shared messages. So that's what Inspiring Women is, and it's growing sort of slowly and steadily every day, and looking at different projects, mentoring projects, and also at the moment looking to work across a number of schools, helping young women to develop confidence. I think that's such a big thing and a key thing. If we can sort of sometimes be more confident and put our hands up a little bit more often and see the value in ourselves, we can make some fantastic changes, I think, for ourselves and for our communities as well.
Brilliant. Well, you touched on it there, Catherine, saying your transfer between rugby and into business. How did you go about making that transition from being a rugby player to a motivational speaker? And why did you decide you wanted to start your own speaker's business?
Yeah, it's definitely been a challenge. And I suppose that's all linked to my own retirement as a rugby player. I retired from England in 2011. I keep saying last year, goodness, that's a long time ago now. And although I carried on playing club rugby and premiership rugby and then actually coaching premiership rugby, I retired from England then. And I always say, actually, retirement was the toughest part of my England career, and still is. And it's a very interesting and interesting time, interesting transition. And when I retired, I was still working at the RFU, but I just felt that I had an impact, more of an impact to make, more of an impact to give. And I really wanted to kind of push push female speakers and female sportswomen, to kind of encourage them to have this platform. Setting up my own business was completely new to me. I was completely out of my comfort zone. I think the very first meeting I went to as CEO of Inspiring Women was at the top floor of a big bank in Canary Wharf. So I set myself a high and more than one target right from the beginning, and learnt quite a lot from that meeting, having gone in with no particular agenda and didn't quite know what I wanted out of the meeting. So I've come a long way since then. But I think, you know, it's just going for it. If you don't try something, you don't know. You know, you'll never know if you're going to achieve it. And and yeah, it has been quite difficult, but I've really enjoyed setting up my own business. I've really enjoyed, providing opportunities for other people. And yeah, it's been tough financially, emotionally at times, but I've loved it. I've really enjoyed it. And to be able to see something grow and develop in front of you. You know, when I was playing rugby for England, it was all about bettering yourself and improving and improving. And it's kind of like that in business as well, you know, wanting to make something better all the time. And and it's so nice, so surprising to know how many people actually want to help. I think the business community is actually a really nice one, and it does feel a bit like being in a team at some times. And you know, it's about creating your own team again. And coming from a team environment, I thought I was out there on my own, you know, setting up this business, and I really wasn't really supported well by a number of different people.
That's a wonderful correlation you make there between rugby and business. Catherine, you mentioned a bit earlier about your speakers. How many do you have currently, and how do you go about selecting them?
Yeah, so I have about 20, 25 speakers now, and which was my aim, that number, and I don't want to have too many more than that. I know all my speakers, and I know that they're good speakers, and I know their stories. Initially, I was going out and finding speakers. And so the first speaker I signed up, if you like, was a young lady or a woman called Benita Norris, who was the first female to stand at both tops of the world, so top of Everest, and the poles as well. And she was fantastic. I first heard her speak at a Youth Sport Trust conference that I was at, and she was really fantastic. She really inspired me. So she was the first speaker I signed up, and the first speaker I put out for a job. And then it was really people that I knew, that I'd met through my time as England captain, throughout other sports. And then the shift has changed the last year or so, that people are female speakers or potential speakers are approaching me because they want to speak and they want to be part of inspiring women. So initially I was going out and trying to find the speakers and now they're approaching me. And I think I've got a really nice range of different speakers from different sports and different adventure backgrounds. And it means that when a business or a company approaches me and they want a speaker, I can really find someone that suits them and suits the message that they want to deliver.
Wonderful. You have so many options there to select from. Catherine, you touched on it just now about the difficulties you experienced when setting up your business. Could you share with us some of those challenges, and what advice would you give other women looking to create a business of their own?
Yeah, absolutely. I think I probably certainly had a couple of confidence crises at different occasions, like, what am I doing? Am I doing the right thing? And and I think it's just being, you know, just being determined and knowing that it's not going to be a straightforward path, a straightforward route. But as long as you have complete focus in what you're doing, you know, in sport and in, you know, when I was playing rugby, there was always something that we were aiming at, you know, whether it was a World Cup. Or within that, you know, there was a Six Nations, and then within that there may have been a friendly international, and then within that there are my own personal strength targets or fitness targets. So I think it's breaking it down, you know, into smaller achievable steps, and when you've done something well, it's remembering to kind of pat yourself on the back. And I think, you know, although there's been people around me helping me, supporting me on a day-to-day basis, it's me being running this company. And you know, quite often I'm sat on my laptop, sat on my desk on my own. So it's important to kind of, you know, celebrate and you know, and give yourself a bit of a well done. But I think for me, the lessons I've learned definitely have been to try to remain focused, because there's been times, you know, when I've tried to go off on these different tangents and you're like, hang on, just remain focused. And I think that's probably the big lesson for myself, and the big kind of a bit of advice I would give to other people wanting to start anything, really, is know where you want to get to initially, know where your first step is, and then where your step is after that, and remain focused to that, and stay determined and stay confident. You know what it is that you want to do, and you feel passionately about something. If you really feel a strong desire in what you're going to do and what you want to do, you will achieve it.
Definitely some advice to take to heart. Did having the values and skills as a former captain of a national team in any way help you in creating your business?
Absolutely, without a doubt. I would not be doing what I am now if I'd not played for England, if I'd not captained England particularly. The confidence I gained through that as a team member, but probably more importantly for me as a leader, was just priceless, really. And you know, it really kind of spurred me on and has fueled what I'm doing now. There's no way I would be doing it if I hadn't gone through that experience. And you know, I have a lot to thank rugby for. I would love to have won a World Cup final and got 3 points away, but I didn't. But what I've taken out from it is just so many skills, experiences, and I think, yeah, confidence, the confidence to be a leader, I think, has been absolutely the biggest one. And to take that forward, you know, running my own business, my own leader, and you know, and being there for other people and influencing other people, that's been the biggest thing, absolutely, for me. And you know what, also, you know, you could put your hand up and you set yourself up and you want to achieve something. If you don't quite get there, it's okay, you know, but you don't have to come crashing down from the mountaintop. You can stay at the top of the mountains and try and reach another peak, you know, and that's very much my kind of my life and my story, if you like. And I didn't quite win a World Cup for England, but I got pretty high trying to get there. And I feel that, you know, I've stayed at the top now while I'm doing what I'm doing now, which is fantastic. And I'm loving it, really.
And that's brilliant to hear. Finally, Catherine, is there any way that other businesses and individuals can get involved and support inspiring women, which will allow your business to grow?
Yeah, absolutely. Well, you know, if anyone's considering considering a conference or would like someone to come in and speak to them, the messages that, you know, transfer across from our female speakers into the workplace are fantastic. And I think what's true for every single one of the inspiring women speakers is that they're an ordinary person and they've just done something quite extraordinary, you know, and they are accessible to the people in the audience. Everyone can see something in themselves, in the speaker in front of them. And I think that's what's very important, you know. They've all been through tough journeys and have achieved something. So absolutely, if anyone is keen to get a speaker into their business, please do contact me. If anyone is keen to discuss confidence workshops, you know, supporting aspiring female leaders in their company, please do contact us, and likewise going into schools as well.
And they can do that by simply visiting your website, www.inspiringwomen.co.uk. Catherine, your experiences on and off the rugby field, as well as your advice on transitioning and running a business, is motivating, to say the least. The Rugby Business Network hopes to see inspiring women flourish and positively influence many more people.
Thank you very much.